and came out white as snow. Just paradoxes like that. And tonight I want to kind of talk about one of those paradoxes in the idea that you have been freed to serve. And we've been talking about this idea of freedom and what it means to be free. And what we've basically discovered is that Christ has made us free from the power of sin. The real message of the cross is not just forgiveness of sin. The real message of the cross is that you don't have to sin anymore. It is the ability to overcome sin. It is the freedom from sin that is the real message of the gospel. And that's what we're talking about today. We've been freed from sin. But what does it mean to be free? Does it mean that we're free to do what we want? We discussed that last week, and Paul would say, God forbid. Does it mean that we're free to sit on our blessed assurance and just wait for Jesus to come back? Does it mean that we're free to do what makes us happy? Does it mean that we are free to just decide what we're going to do today? Is that the kind of freedom that God gives us? Does being free from sin, does that mean that we are free from being a servant altogether? And I think we would all agree and say, by no means. God has freed us for the very purpose of servanthood. He has freed us from bondage so that we can be a servant. He has freed us from the enemy so that we can serve Him. Nobody, no person in this entire world is free from servanthood. Everybody serves someone or something. Every single person, whether you are a Christian or a non-Christian, whether you sit in this house or another house, it does not matter. You will serve someone. You will either serve God or you will serve the enemy. You will either serve righteousness or you will serve sin. You will either serve God or mammon, as Jesus would call it. You would either serve God or ourselves. But all of us serve someone or something. Before we came to Christ, we had no choice about who we would serve. In other words, we served our flesh. We served sin. And that had control of us. We had no say-so in the matter. It controlled everything we did, everything we said. Sin controlled us. But now that we've come to Christ, we have control over it. We have power over sin, and we don't have to sin any longer. But now we are free to choose who we will serve. That's really what we're looking at today, is who are we going to choose to serve? Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But it is a choice that we have to make. We have to make the choice to serve. We don't have to serve sin, but we have to serve someone. In other words, Jesus said, His yoke is easy and His burden is light. But make no mistake, He has a yoke and He has a burden that He wants you to wear. He says, it's not as hard as that one that you used to carry. It's not as heavy as the one that you were pulling. But understand, you still have a yoke to wear. And you still have a burden to pull. God says, I have got one for you the same as you've had, but mine is easy and mine is light. But there is an expectation when we come to Christ that we are coming with the sole purpose of being His servant. That's what Paul said when he called himself the bondservant to Christ. He said, not because I have to, but because I choose to. Because I have chosen to follow Christ. That's the reason I'm following Him. He says, I'm that guy who didn't owe a debt, but because I loved my master so much, I chose to be His servant. He bought you with a price. And He has brought you into His family. And as a result, you're now part of the family business. You are part of the family business, and you have got a place and a job and a role to play in His kingdom. God has chosen you for that purpose. In other words, He has freed us so that we can serve in His kingdom. But the choice is ours. See, that's the thing about God. And I almost titled this God's Pro-Choice, but I thought that would be wrong to do. But God is pro-choice in the sense that you have a choice. God never forces His opinion. He never forces anything on you. He will not force His yoke around your neck. He will not force you to pull the burden. The choice always has to be ours. We have to step forward and say, God, I want Your yoke. I want Your burden. And we place it around our own necks. God says, you have a choice. You always have a choice. Jesus had a choice. Jesus had a choice when He was in the garden. He said, if there be any other way, take this cup from Me. Jesus did not have to go to the cross for you or me. He could have easily walked away. He could have easily said, I'm not going to do it. Look at the way these people treat me. Look at the way the church is today. These people aren't even worthy of it. They're just going to despise me. They're going to argue with each other and come up with all these different denominations. It's not worth it. He could have walked away. He chose to say, not my will, but your will be done. He chose to leave heaven. He chose to come to this earth. He made Himself a servant. And He is our example. We are to make ourselves servants unto God. When we talk about the parable of the prodigal son, though he was a son, he returned to his father's house for the purpose of becoming a servant by choice. He said, I don't want to be a son anymore. I just want to be a servant in my father's house. Paul describes himself as a servant of Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, John is referred to as the servant of God. Jude is called the servant of Jesus Christ. Simon Peter calls himself a servant of Jesus Christ. James, a servant. Colossians 4:12 tells us of a man named Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ. Phoebe is described as a servant. David, Moses, Elijah, all considered to be servants of God. And every single one of them chose to serve Him. Every single one of them stepped forward and say, place the yoke around my neck. I will carry the burden for You, God, because I know that I have to serve somebody. So I might as well serve God. We have to do the same thing. We have to choose to be His servants, His bond servants. Not necessarily that we have to do it, but because we want to do it. See, in the Old Testament, I know I've talked about this before, if you were forced into slavery, if you were forced to be a servant because you had a debt you couldn't pay, then once your debt was paid off, you were free to go. However, there were those people who realized that my life now is a lot better than it was when I was taking care of myself. And because they loved their master and because they loved the person so much, they said, you know what? I don't want to be free. I want to be your servant. And they would take him to the door and they would pierce their ear with an awl. And then from that day forward, every time someone saw their ear, they would know that person's a servant by choice. By choice. It was a difference between being forced into servanthood, which is what the enemy does to you. He forces you into servanthood. But Jesus freed you. And now you have a choice to serve Him. And God wants us to make that choice. You know, it's easy to submit to someone and to become a servant to someone that you trust. It's easy to submit and serve somebody that you know loves you and has your best interest at mind. It's easy to serve that kind of a person. It's easy to entrust them with everything you have and everything you are when you know that they were willing to die for you. And that's what Christ did. And He asks us one thing, serve Me. God has great plans for each of us. Me, you, even those out there living in the world. God has a plan for their life if they would only come to realize the plan that He has for them. God has a plan. Even before you were born, God had a plan for you. He had a purpose for you. The Bible says for Jeremiah, He said, even before I formed you in the womb, I knew you and called you and set you apart to be a prophet. And you know, He's not the only one. Isaiah says that he was called from the womb. Even before he had seen the light of day, he already knew that he had a plan and a purpose. And he knew that God had called him to serve in His kingdom. John the Baptist was created for a purpose. And that was to prepare the way for Jesus Christ. All of them were born for a purpose, and so were you. God has a plan and a purpose for your life. And He will lead you into that plan, and He will lead you into that purpose if you will come to Him with one goal, and that's to simply serve Him. God has called each of us to serve in His kingdom, to be kings and priests, prophets and pastors, teachers, evangelists, apostles. You were born to be a servant of God. You were born for that purpose. But you have to choose whether or not you're going to willingly take the yoke and carry the burden. Christ did not pay such a great price just for us to sit around and do nothing and wait for Him to come. Christ paid a great price for us. It goes beyond the price of just dying on a cross. But there was so much more. The giving up of His glory. The willingness to suffer. The willingness to be mocked and all of that stuff. He paid a great price for you and I. And He did it so that we could be world changers. He did it so that we could have and be what He's called us to be. He's placed His kingdom in the hands of His servants today. You are responsible for the kingdom of God. That's a heavy burden to carry, but it's still lighter than the one of sin. God has placed His kingdom in our hands, in your hands. And the question is, what are we going to do with it? As His servants, we're supposed to be working in the fields. Do you realize today that there are people who need the gospel sown into their life? Right now, there's seed that's been planted that somebody needs to be watering. There are people ripe for the harvest. And we're praying, God, send laborers into the harvest. But yet, are we willing to go ourselves? Are we willing to plant the seed? Are we willing to water the seed? Are we willing to go out there and the crop for the kingdom of God? That's what we're supposed to be doing. We've been called to be His servants, serving in His kingdom. That's why we are here today. We are supposed to be expanding His kingdom. You're supposed to be going out there right now, invading the kingdom of darkness. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be out there setting the captives free. We're supposed to be destroying the works of the enemy. Are we doing that? Are we being that kind of a servant in the kingdom of God? We're supposed to be feeding His sheep. We're supposed to be caring one for another. We're supposed to be feeding one another. We're supposed to be caring for one another in His kingdom. We're supposed to be visiting the sick, those that are imprisoned, clothing the naked, feeding the hungry. That's what we're supposed to be doing as servants of God. We're supposed to be making disciples. We're supposed to be going forth and preaching the gospel to every creature. We're supposed to be teaching others what it means to be servants of God. And we're supposed to be empowering people to do what God has called them to do. And each of us will do that in a different way. But every one of us has a work to do. Mark chapter 13, you can write this down. I didn't put it on the overhead today, but Mark chapter 13, verse 34 through 36. It says, "For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, and every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch. Watch ye therefore, for you know not when the master of the house cometh, at even, or at midday, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping." What are we doing for the kingdom of God? He has gone away on a far journey, and he has called his servants to him, you and I. He has called us, and he has given every one of us a work to do. Every one of us a work, every one of us something to do. And he has left us with a charge and says, take care of my kingdom. Expand my kingdom. It says, and one day he's going to come back. And when he comes back, what will he find his servants doing? Will he find us being faithful? Will he find us working in the field? Will he find us making disciples? Will he find us visiting the sick and the imprisoned? Will he find us clothing the naked and feeding the hungry? Will he find us doing what he asked us to do? Or will he find us sleeping? In other words, where we just look at ourselves and we say, thank God I'm free. And I'm just going to sit here and enjoy my freedom. We have been freed not to be lazy. We have been freed not to enjoy the free life. We have been freed to serve in His kingdom. When Christ comes, what will He find us doing? Romans 14:12 says, "So when every one of us shall give an account of himself to God." One day we'll stand before God and we'll give an account of what we've done and what we haven't done. When He comes, He will require an account from His servants. The Bible tells us many stories about that. Jesus tells the parable of the talents, where He calls again. He brings His servants together, and He gives one of them one talent, and another one He gives two, and to the other one He gives five talents. And He goes away. And while He's gone, the one who'd had five talents, it says He made five more. And the one who had the two talents, he gained two more. But the one who had the one talent said, you know what? If anything happens to this, I know I'm going to get in trouble. So he went out and he digs a hole and he buries it. And then the master comes back and he calls his servants to give an account. And the one that had five said, here, you gave me five, now you have ten. The one who had two, he says, you gave me two, now you have four. He says, and the one went down and dug up his talent and brought it to the master and said, I knew that you'd be very angry if I lost this. So I want you to know that I kept it safe for you. And here it is. Every single cent, every single bit of it. Didn't lose any of it. And the master said, you are a wicked and lazy servant. Wicked and lazy servant. And here's what really boggles my mind is the fact that it says, he then said, take from him what he had. Give me that talent. Give it to the one who has ten, and then throw him out where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. You were my servant, but because you were lazy with what I gave you, I will take it from you and you will have your part with those that are weeping and gnashing of teeth. That just sounds weird because we don't think of God doing stuff like that. We think of God as this loving God who will just forgive us and He will. But at the same time, he expects us to yoke up. He expects us to pull our weight. He expects us to be serving in his kingdom, not being served in his kingdom. God does not want us to be a sponge that just sits, soaks, and sours. God wants us to be the kind of sponge that is constantly being filled and constantly being wrung out into the lives of other people. He wants us to allow ourselves to be used, a continuous flow of his grace and his mercy and his spirit flowing through us. Not a dead sea that just collects and kills everything that's around it. God is calling us to do much more. In Luke chapter 12, it says, "And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward?" Another word for servant. "Whom his Lord shall make ruler over his household to give him their portion of meat in due season. Blessed is that servant whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find him so doing. Of a truth I say unto you that he will make him ruler over all that he has." In other words, he says, if I find you doing what I asked you to do, then I will make you ruler over much. And now he says, if you'll be faithful with the little, I will make you ruler over much. But this part is what really grabs me. He says, "But if that servant says in his heart, my Lord delays his coming, and shall begin to beat the men servants and the maidens, and to eat and drink and be drunken, the Lord of that servant will come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him asunder, and will appoint him his portion with the unbelievers." Again, this concept of, I've left you something to do, and if you decide to sit around and get fat on my blessing. In other words, if you choose to be like Jeshurun of the Old Testament, he says, I will take from you and I will put you out. I did not call you here to just be blessed. I blessed you to bless those that are around you. I did not call you to be the master of the house. I have called you to be the servant in the house. Is what Christ is telling them. He says, and if you do not do what I've asked you to do, if you fail to be the servant that I've called you to be, then understand your portion will be with the unbelievers. And then in Matthew 25, the Bible says that he separates his servants, his followers. This isn't sinners and saints. It says he called his servants. And he separated them into two lines, the left and the right. On the right he placed the sheep, and the left he placed the goats. It says, and he led them to their eternal destiny. Those on the right, the sheep, it says he led them into eternal glory. Those on the left, the goats, it says he led them into eternal damnation. His servants. What's the difference between a goat and a sheep? This is what it says. He says, the difference is that when I was hungry, you didn't feed me. I was hungry, and instead of serving me, you let me go hungry. Therefore, you're a goat. He said, when I was a stranger, you did not welcome me. And therefore, you must go to the left. When I was naked, you didn't clothe me. When I was sick, you didn't care for me. When I was in prison, you didn't visit me. In every case, it was the poor service of the servant that caused them to be separated and cast out. I tell you this tonight because we have got to understand God has a plan for you and for me. And we must be about his business. I would not be a man of God standing here if I allowed people to continue to think that they can keep flowing and coasting their way through life, that one day God's going to welcome them in with a well done, good and faithful servant. I think it's interesting that that's what he's going to say. Well done, good and faithful servant. But what if it wasn't well done? What if you weren't faithful? How can he welcome us into that place? God has called us to great things. Being free from sin does not free us from responsibility. And being a servant does not gain us reward, favor, or even gratitude. Do you realize that today? You will not earn anything from God. The blessings that He has for you, the gifts that He has for you, the Spirit that He's given you has nothing to do with your service. Has nothing to do with you being a servant of His. You got those because you are His child. Here's what it says. As I was studying this out, Luke chapter 17, it says, "But which of you, having a servant plowing or feeding cattle, will say unto him by and by when he comes from the field, go and sit down to meat?" In other words, how many of you, if you've got a servant who's been working all day, when he comes in, will tell him, "Oh, I'll take care of this"? He says, "And will not rather you say unto him, make ready for me to sup, and then when you're done, then you can eat? But I've labored in the field all day long, and I'm tired, and I've got this going on, and you don't know what I've done. And now I come in, and the master looks at me and says, now I want you to do this too." And we begin to whine and cry because, He's saying, but that's what we do. That's what a servant does. He says, when the servant comes in from serving, you know what you do next? You serve. But I've done my part. You're still got to serve. There's always service to be done. Always service to be done. And we are always serving the master first. We never get a chance to take a day off. We never get a chance to say, I'm done for the day. If the master calls, it's time to respond. Because he is the master and we are the servant. And he says, even after you do that, even after he comes in and you tell him, go fix my supper, and he does it. This is what he says. Does he thank that servant? Because he did the things that he was commanded to do? He said, absolutely not. He said he doesn't even get thanks for it. He doesn't even get shown gratitude for it. It's almost as if it's just expected that you do it. We live in a weird culture today where people go to a job and they do the minimum that's required of them and they expect people to put on a parade because they came to work. We expect people to shower us with gifts because we did our job. Do you understand today that Jesus says you're not going to get any of that? He says you're not going to get it. He said, you're simply doing what's been expected of you to do. He says, so likewise you, when you have done all the things which were commanded you, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done that which is our duty to do. We've just done it because it was our duty to do. Not because we need accolades, not because we expect somebody to come along and pat us on the back, not because we're looking for someone to slip us a Pentecostal handshake. That's not what we're looking for. He said, just be glad that you've done it, that you were obedient to the master who asked you to do it. That's all it takes. In other words, just labor for me. He said, the reward will come. The reward will come. It's already there. It's waiting for you. It's on hold, waiting for you to arrive. But don't disqualify yourself here by being a poor servant. See, that's the thing. God doesn't give us a paycheck here. He says the paycheck's there. You've got a retirement package, a severance package waiting for you. Don't give up on it. Don't quit here and forfeit what's there waiting for you. He said, be a servant now, and it will pay dividends in the future. Be a servant now, and it will be worth it when you see what I have for you. Be a servant. So the question, I guess, as I end is, why do it? Why serve God at all? I mean, why serve God if I'm not going to get anything out of it here? Can't I just sit and be happy that God has saved me? Why can't I just sit and sour? Why can't I just grow crusty, musty, dusty in my faith? Why can't I just be happy that I'm on my way to heaven? Why do I even need to do anything beyond that? Works doesn't save me. It's because what other option do you have? You will serve someone. Jesus was sitting around with his disciples, and he began to tell people what it was going to take to be his disciple. And some people said, you know what, that's too much. And they got up and began to leave. And Jesus looked at his disciples, he said, are you going to leave too? And the one who always had to talk, Peter, said something that was actually kind of brilliant. He said, Lord, to whom shall we go? Where are we going to go? You will serve somebody. You can either serve the God of this world and wear His yoke and carry His burden all the way to hell. Or you can carry the burden of Christ. You can carry your cross. You can put His yoke upon you and do His work. And watch Him bless your life. And watch Him care for you. And watch Him lead you into a place of glory. You will serve somebody, but the choice is yours. Who will you serve this side of eternity?